नमः शांताय तेजसे। गुड इवनिंग लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन, आई वेलकम यू ऑल ऑन द ओकेजन ऑफ द 12th प्रभा जोशी मेमोरियल लेक्चर। आई वेलकम ऑल डिग्नेटरीज एंड आई रिक्वेस्ट द ऑनररी सेक्रेटरी डॉक्टर श्रीकांत बहुलकर टू वेलकम यू ऑल एंड टू से अ फ्यू वर्ड्स अबाउट डॉक्टर प्रभा जोशी एंड दिस मेमोरियल लेक्चर सीरीज एंड ऑल्सो टू इंट्रोड्यूस टूडेज स्पीकर।
फ्रेंड्स, इट गिव्स मी इमेंस प्लेजर टू बी विथ यू दिस इवनिंग ऑन द ओकेजन ऑफ Dr. Prabha Joshi Memorial Lecture on socio-religious context of rare Jain renderings by Professor Maruti Nandan Tiwari of Banaras Hindu University. Dr. Prabha Joshi was born on February 5, 1927 in Maswad, Sangli district, and did her school education in Girls High School, Sangli. At the matriculation examination, she was awarded the Bidker Prize of the Bombay University. She studied for 2 years at the Willingdon College, Sangli, and after the inter-arts examination, she joined the Wilson College, Bombay, and obtained the BA honors degree in 1949. She was awarded the prestigious Bhau Daji and the Purushottam Das Bhagwan Das Prize of the Bombay University for securing the highest number of marks in Sanskrit at the BA examination. She was also awarded the Sokar Bai Mankar Scholarship for securing the first rank among the lady students at the graduate level. She worked as Dakshina Fellow at the Wilson College and continued her studies for the MA degree in Sanskrit. She was awarded the Chancellor's Gold Medal for securing the highest marks in the language group at the Master of Arts examination. She then continued to work for the PhD degree under the guidance of Professor H.D. Velankar at the Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan, Bombay, and obtained the PhD degree in 1955. Her thesis was entitled Non-Aryan Element in the Rigveda. She was a lecturer in Sanskrit at the Ismail Yusuf College, Bombay during 1954-55. She moved with her husband to Cambridge University, England for 1 year and to the University of Chicago, USA. At the University of Chicago, she worked as a research associate at the Department of Humanities and took credit courses in German language and linguistics for Professor Bobrinsky, Professor of Sanskrit at the university. She prepared gleanings from Sanskrit literature consisting of English translation of Sanskrit passages representing the various periods of Sanskrit literature. After return to India, she worked from 1959 to 60 as a research assistant in the dictionary department of the Deccan College, Pune. The work involved collection of data, namely going through the Puranas to note the occurrences of some words and their meanings. From 1960 to 62, she was lecturer in Sanskrit in the Ferguson College, Pune, and taught undergraduate students many texts like Veni Samhara, Malavikagni Mitra, and Tarkasangra. She then moved to Bombay and taught Sanskrit at the Patkar College, Goregaon, from 1966 to 82. She taught Vikramor Vashiyam, Swapnavasav Dattam, Ratnavali, Charudattam, and some portions of the epics and lyrics. She also taught parts of the Bhagavad Gita, Brahma Sutra, Shankara Bhashya, and Kautilya's Arthashastra. In 1982, she moved to Athens, Georgia with her husband, but unfortunately, at the University of Georgia, she was unable to find a suitable position to pursue her teachings. She translated in Marathi the biography of Martin Luther King's father, Daddy King, and this remains as an unpublished manuscript. She suffered from asthma from a young age and passed away peacefully on March 10, 1992. Today's speaker, Professor Maruti Nandan Tiwari. He is currently an emeritus professor in History of Arts Department, Banaras Hindu University. He was professor in the Department of History of Art, BHU, and had headed the department for 3 times under the rotation system. His publications deal extensively with different aspects of Indian art and iconography, especially Jain art and iconography. He has many books to his credit: Jain Pratima Vidyan, Elements of Jain Iconography, Ambika in Jain Art and Literature, Khajuraho Ka Jain Puratattva, Jain Kala Tirtha, Devgar, Madhyakalin Bharatiya Murti Kala, and Madhyakalin Bharatiya Pratima Lakshan, to name a few. His academic pursuits and publications have brought several honors and awards to him. He was invited by the President of India to Rashtrapati Bhavan 2 times. He was awarded Acharya Narendra Dev Puraskar by Hindi Sansthan UP and Indira Gandhi National Rajya Sabha Rajya Bhasha Award from Delhi. He has been invited for lectures, including keynote addresses at SOAS London and University of Cardiff, UK, Nehru Center, London, and Berlin University, Germany. I welcome him and offer him flower of bouquet. Today's chairperson, Shri Abhayji Firodia, is known to us all. He is the president of Firodia Trust and also chairman of Regulating Council of Bhandarka Orient Institute. And under his able guidance, the institute is making good progress. You see this newly built auditorium, a heritage building, converted into a good auditorium and also conference hall. And all this has been done during the past 2 or 3 years under his guidance. He is also taking keen interest in various academic activities and infrastructural development, and recently he has also started the work of making an amphitheater on the premises under the banyan tree on this premises. So I welcome him and offer him. And I request today's speaker to begin his lecture. Thank you.
Respected Firodia ji, Dr. Bahulkar ji, and friends in the audience, and especially my classmate and friend Mr. P.P.P. Sharma, who has been additional DG over here in Pune, who has come. Of course, I'm really very happy to be here and share some of my views on some of the rare Jain images. I will gradually proceed and you will then gradually enjoy the thing. First of all, I must offer my thanks for being invited for Prabha Joshi Memorial Lecture over here. It's a wonderful auditorium. Before I start, I must repeat, which I have just repeated, the basic concept of भारतीय संस्कृति और इंडियन कल्चर हैज बीन एंड शुड बी, विच अनफॉर्चुनेटली इज नॉट टुडे, एकम सत विप्रा बहुधा वदन्ति. ऋग्वेद सेज द ट्रूथ और अल्टीमेट इज वन एंड इट इज व्यूड, इट इज सीन इन डिफरेंट फॉर्म्स, इन डिफरेंट थ्रू डिफरेंट नेम्स. अगेन इट रिपीट्स रूपम रूपम प्रतिरूपो बभूव. वी फाइंड द इमेजेस ऑफ बुद्ध, वी फाइंड इमेजेस ऑफ विष्णु, शिव, शक्ति, सूर्य, द जैन तीर्थंकरस. बट बेसिकली द कॉन्सेप्ट सेज दैट इट इज द मैनिफेस्टेशन ऑफ वन बेसिक फॉर्म, अल्टीमेट फॉर्म, रूपम रूपम प्रतिरूपो बभूव. ही और द अल्टीमेट मैनिफेस्ट्स हिमसेल्फ इनटू मेनी फॉर्म्स. सो इफ दिस इज केप्ट इन माइंड, रिलीजन कैन नेवर बी ए पॉइंट ऑफ कन्फ्लिक्ट और स्ट्राइफ और संघर्ष, विच वी फाइंड टुडे व्हाट इज हैपनिंग. So with this basic notion I start, and just one few points at the outset. When we talk about the divine images, icons, pratima, we must keep in mind we are fighting for Vishnu, we are fighting for that it is our Buddha, it is our Tirthankar, it is our Vishnu, he is superior, he is inferior. These are all the conceptual forms, mental image. Nobody has seen Vishnu, nobody has seen Shiva, nobody has seen any Tirthankar or Buddha. Therefore, these are not the portraits. So conceptual form, mental image they are. And how? I will repeat. Just taking the example of the Jain Tirthankaras. The Jainism comes, is the part of the whole of Indian culture, an essential part of whole of Indian culture, giving special stress on austerity, non-acquisition, that is a parigraha, renunciation, that is tyag, then non-violence, ahimsa. These are all so essential today, so relevant today for the peace. Peace of humanity, peace of world, peace of at every level. So how the form of the Tirthankaras were conceptualized? When they became an ideal for the society, because they were vitaragis, free from desire and passion. Following these paths I have just said. So how to visualize, have them in human forms, yeah, in body forms. So they have combined three, the features of yogi, shant, the tranquility over the face, the eyes, as well as the postures. Very important in the context of Jainism and Jain art, very important. And something very special about it also, I will be telling. Then Chakravarti, how the fusion is being made. They took loin throne, fly whisk bearing Chamardharas, and then the insignia of Mahapurush, great man, hollow, long hanging arms, long ears. So when these combine and a beautiful youthful form was created, it came to be known as Vitaragi Tirthankaras. who were shown only in two exclusive postures, Dhyan Mudra, sitting cross-legged, and standing erect in Kayotsarga Mudra. And Kayotsarga Mudra has been a distinct feature of Jainism and Jain art. In no other Indian image, this posture is being found. And this posture reminds us of the principles for which the Tirthankara stand. Second point is that these are all the manifestation of the collective wisdom, experience and faith, collective. And therefore, they always are concerned about the original concept which we find in the Vedas, Rig Vedas. We must not think in the terms that the Rig Vedas belong to Hindus, not the Jainas, not the Buddhists, no. How can we say? At that point of time, there was no cult, no divisive schism. So therefore, it was pan-Indian culture, religion, faith, whatever you may call. Then I will straightway come to the rare on which I am going to speak, because I know that I have so many visuals which is going to interest you all. Why do we call them rare or viral or vilakshan or durlabh or dushprapta? The word itself explains. But why? First, to break the monotony. Rare images were carved and created and recreated and created. Right from the Kushan period down to the 20th century, in every region of India. How did they do it? Because one misgiving is about Jain art is that Jain art is a monotonous art. Everywhere we find the two Tirthankaras, either standing or sitting, the same posture, number of hands two, no ornament. So it creates monotony. But I tell you, I have seen thousands and thousands of images, and no two images I could ever find that they are exactly similar. So through the compositional changes in the parikar or the surrounding, they have changed the format. The monotony is broken. Through the induction of the figures of the Navagrahas, Saraswati, Lakshmi, and likewise a number of other figures, they have been making the changes. And that sometimes make the images rare. Second point was that the rare images which we find, which we will be just looking at, were the contribution of the local tradition, which were either unrecorded or are not available to us presently, or they belong to lost tradition. Third is, the rare they have made, they have introduced certain changes about which we do not find any mention in the texts. But those rare images do not violate what the texts say indoors. So without violating the textual injunctions, they have made certain changes to cater to the need or aspirations of the contemporary society or break the monotony, which we will be just showing, and also for the sake of mutuality and assimilation. This was it, because we talk about exclusive, but now the time has come that whether it is in the context of the art, whether it is context of the culture or religion or faith, we must talk inclusive. And inclusiveness was the basic character of Bharatiya Dharma Sanskriti Kala. Saraswati you find in all. Can we say that Saraswati is Jain? Saraswati is Buddhist? Saraswati is Brahmanical? No. Saraswati is the goddess of wisdom. Wisdom which is needed for all, for every society, for every time. Lakshmi, the goddess of prosperity, equally needed for all. Ganesh, Navagrahas. So these were assimilated, and for that we won't say that these were assimilated from where? From Brahmanical, from Jain. So if we start thinking in this term, we will just narrow down the broad path the Indian tradition, Indian art, and Indian culture has shown. And they were always thinking in terms that we should also think in that term. So now I should go with the visuals. Visuals, please. This is a map. Pointer shayad nahi hai, koi baat nahi. Anyway, wherein I have shown most important Jain sites spread over all over the country. And only few I have shown: Shraman Belagol, Ellora, Tranakpur, Khajuraho, Rajgir. So few of the sites I have marked through the pictures or the visuals. But this map itself shows the distribution of Jain art or Jain sites throughout the country, like what we get in the context of the Brahmanical art or Vedic Puranic art. But Buddhist art does not stand to it, because after 7th, 8th century, it gradually started disappearing or was confined to certain particular regions. Next, please. This I have talked about. This is the earliest image of Saraswati. Since this was installed by the Jain Acharya, it becomes contextually the Jain image of Saraswati, but not Jain Saraswati, Jain image of Saraswati. And important is that she holds a manuscript, one can see. Other hand was in Abhay Mudra holding the rosary. Some remnant of that is still could be seen. But what is important is apart from this image being the earliest known Saraswati image in India, the date is given. And date is in Shak Samvat 54, which comes to 132 CE, early 2nd century. The name of Saraswati is given, the name of donor is given, who is none else but Lauha Karmak, iron smith. And another very important point is, the inscription also shows that this image of Saraswati was installed for Sarva Sattva Naam Hit Sukha, not for the welfare and happiness of the Jainas or the Nirgranthas, but all. This all is very important, which could be connected Ekam Sat Vipra Bhavadavati. So religion, any religion, any image, if it is meant for the welfare of only a limited section of society or the people, will not serve the purpose, will not serve the spirit of Indian tradition, and which you find here. And this all could happen only after the Gupta period, or say towards the close of the Gupta period. Next, please. Again, Saraswati from Khajuraho, Parshunath Jain Temple. The date is already given, 950-970 CE. And that side you find two Tirthankaras, and along with two Tirthankaras on the same image format, you find the image of Saraswati. It becomes rare. Rare in the context that Saraswati as a Shruta Devata, the presiding goddess of the Agamic literature or the Jinvani, she was personified as goddess of wisdom, and she was given such an exalted position that she was put at par with the Tirthankaras and shown with the Tirthankaras, who Tirthankara's genus were the highest in Jain worship. So whosoever was to be elevated in Jainism, any personality, any Shalaka Purush, he was put at par with the Tirthankaras, and therefore this is a rare Jain image of Saraswati from Devgarh, and the date is also given. Next, please. So beautiful you find. From central India, the image is at the moment in British Museum, London, Parmar style. So beautiful, so graceful, pleasing. Because again, this is also said that the Jain art has been dry. No aesthetic value, no aesthetic appeal. You yourself see the aesthetic appeal of this image, and that aesthetic appeal is so graceful that it attracts anybody. She holds the manuscript and the other things. The Jin figures could be shown in the Parikar. Parikar means the figures along the main figure. Second one is one of the best Saraswati image, which comes from Pallu in Bikaner district. So beautiful, ornate. Here ornamentation is there, but it is graceful. Their ornamentation is heavy and carved with dexterity. Sukshma alankaran ukeran hai uska. Or third, you find again Saraswati in Vimal Vasahi ceiling, Dilwara, 1150. And what is important is that on the two sides you find two figures standing close to Saraswati. Saraswati means she will be holding invariably a manuscript, lotus, water vessel, and subsequently she was also provided with Veena in Jain context also. These figures are very important, and the names are given as Kela and Loyan. They were the main sculptor and architect of Dilwara Jain temple. This is very important. Means Saraswati has been represented as the goddess of fine arts as well as the architecture also. All arts. So this is how gradually the change comes in 12th century, and the name is given here. Next, please. A few examples of the temples. Shantinath temple, Parshunath Jain temple, equally in North India and Gujarat and Rajasthan, of course, are very, very rich so far as Jain temples are concerned. Next, please. Taranga in Gujarat, Ranakpur, and this is Shatrunjay, Palita. Just to see a place where from
say about 7th, 8th century down to the 20th century, thousands of temples were erected in continuity with the sculptures. So the Jainas, who were representing on one side the Vitaragi Tirthankaras, dispassionate Tirthankaras, they were to bless you with the path of austerity, renunciation, and you shouldn't expect from them any worldly things. But at the same time, Jainas were living in the world, and therefore the worldly things, the decoration, the aesthetic things, the beautiful damsels, apsaras, and up to the point of erotic figures, they did come. So they were going with the time, a time which was associated or related to the society, the contemporary society, to cater to their need and aspirations. Earliest definite jinn image is from Lohanipur, 3rd century BCE, Mauryan Polish, Mauryan period, and it is in Patna Museum. And it is supported by several evidences. It becomes the rare, because the Tirthankaras did not restrict for making their images one. Second, we have the tradition of making of Jivant Swami images, which were carved in the lifetime of Mahavir in 6th century BCE. Third, we have the inscription of Kharvel of 2nd, 1st century BCE, wherein an image, Kaling Jinn, it is called in inscription, was taken away by Nandaraj and which was brought back by Kharvel after 300 years. Means the antiquity goes to 3rd, 4th century BCE. And therefore, it becomes the earliest cult image in Indian context. The Jainas are credited with having the earliest cult image in the context of art. And this image is from Harappa. It looks like that it has some similarity with that image, but not exactly the same. This should be taken as a figure of yogi, or we should wait until the Indus Valley script is finally deciphered. Although some of the earlier scholars like R.P. Chandati and Ramchandran, they have identified this figure as an image of Jain Tirthankar. But to my mind, being a student of history, I should wait till the script is being deciphered next week. The inscription again says Chandra Prabha, 8th Tirthankar inscribed from Durjanpur. And what is uniqueness? Uniqueness is, it refers to Maharaja Dhiraj Ramgupt. A student of history knows that Ramgupt, the mention of Ramgupt is not found in any of the Gupta inscriptions. So after Samudragupta, Chandragupta only comes. But in between Samudra and Chandragupta, there was a king, Ramgupt, about which we have literary tradition which belonged to later days. But this image of early 4th century confirms that there was a ruler, Ramgupta, who had the title Maharaja Dhiraj, which was an epithet exclusive of the Gupta rulers. So therefore it becomes unique. Another, the earliest Shvetambar image. Although there is a point that Mathura images belong to the Gambar tradition. But there was a scholar who is unfortunately not presently alive, Professor M.A. Dhaki. I have learned so much from him. And I had a discussion and he told me, no, the Mathura Kushan images represent undifferentiated age of Jainism or Jaina. When there was no clear distinction or difference between of the Shvetambala and the Mathura, no emergence. And therefore we find both the themes. I will just show gradually. And this image is, you find he is clad in dhoti, Shvetambar, metal image, from Akota in Gujarat. So beautiful, look, much mutilated, but still you can see the hanging hair locks, and on the face, the divine look, the grace of a yogi, who is in the process of inward look, looking into self. Next, please. This is a rare image. What is special? It comes from a very important, prolific Jain center, Digambar Jain center, Devgarh in Lalitpur. Image is of Rishabhnath, and just below the Rishabhnath figure, who is having the cognizance bull, you find two Upadhyayas engaged in disputation, Shastrarth. So this image is unique in the sense that it gives almost equal space to the Upadhyayas as we find in case of the Upadhyayas. And also, how important was the Shastrarth during those times. Both are having the manuscript in their hand, and in the center you find Sthapana, where the book is being placed. Next image is again unique, and it is in British Museum, and it comes under composite images. The Jainas also attempted at, because Jainas did all that what was being practiced in contemporary art. No matter Brahminical, Buddhist, Jain, they practice. And here you find Rishabhnath and Mahavir. So beautiful, you see. The hairdo of Rishabhnath, then Mahavir, having Trishatra and all that. And this comes from Orissa. So beautifully. With your aesthetic appeal, you can yourself see. And therefore, composite images, when the two Tirthankaras are put together in Dvitirthi, or four Tirthankaras are put on Pratima Sarvato Bhadrika, or fourfold image, means the four or two or three Tirthankaras are put together at par. When they are at par, who are we to think in terms of that Rishabhnath is superior, Mahavir is superior? And this was done. And this was the intention of introducing the composite images, to just tell that there should not be any conflict in terms of the superiority of any Tirthankar or any images in other context, Brahminical. Harihar is there, Vishnu Shiv. Ardhanarishwar is there, equal in one image. So that's why they have also introduced. Next. Neminath, the 22nd Jain. And the Jainas developed a kinship with the Vaishnavism, which is still continuing. I have observed that in most of the Jain temples, the priests are still the Vaishnavas. So they have very good relations with the Vaishnavism. And Balaram and Krishna, the two epical characters, they are said to have been the cousin brothers of the 22nd Jain Neminath. So this is how the fusion or assimilation process starts. The texts like Antgat Dasao, Naya Dhamma Kahao, Trishashti Shalaka Purush Charita, they all refer to this. Shwetambar as well as Digambar. And here you can see Balaram on one side, Vasudeva Krishna on the other. Above is image from Mathura. There also you can see Balaram on the right and Vasudeva Krishna on the left. There it comes from Digambar side, Devgarh, Balaram and Vasudeva Krishna. So means process of assimilation, cordiality, harmony. These images tell so much about the social, contemporary social context. The only thing is that we should try to understand them, read them faithfully, correctly, and in the spirit of the Indian tradition. Next. Rare, because earliest image, where do we find the cognizance conch of Nemirad? They were making innovations, you see. Neminath image, which is in Cleveland Museum. Just wonderful, you see. How beautifully on a big conch Neminath stands. This is the imagination. And you have been seeing the images so far. Could you find any two images being exactly similar? Perhaps you won't find. Next. Then comes Parshvanath in the sanctum sanctorum of the Parshvanath Jain temple Khajuraho from Nachna. And here you find from Ellora, a very important rock place of rock cut sculptures and architecture, confluence of all the three religions, Buddhism, Buddhist art, Brahminical art, Jain art, all you find together. Simultaneously, one after the other. And what is important is that in the image you find that a Tirthankar Parshvanath stands under the shade of 7 hooded snake canopy in Kayotsarg. This Kayotsarg posture, which was always reminding of the Vitaragi Swarup of the Tirthankaras, and also how did they bear the inflictions or the upasargas caused by the demonic characters like Kamat, you see in the Parikar, on the lion throwing a stone above. So the inflictions are being caused to Parshvanath during the course of his tapas, but he remained unshaken, shant, unperturbed. And finally, Meghmali or Kamat had to come for apology. And here comes the difference from Buddhist art and Jain art. Jainas have never compromised with their basic tenets of non-violence, renunciation, non-acquisition, and therefore no other posture than the Dhyan Mudra and the Kayotsarg of meditation. While in Buddhism, what do you find? Buddha, just from the Kushan period onward, started being involved in the worldly affairs by way of, because the images in their silence say so much. The point is that you should try to understand. They are the big texts. Big texts. On the basis of the text, we should try to read them, and very sympathetically, and in the proper context of their tradition. Buddha was to be shown in Abhay Mudra, safety bestowing gestures, worldly. Yes, you come to me, I show you up to the protection. Buddha started to be shown in Varad Mudra, boon conferring gesture. Jainas did never do it. Why? Deliberately. They did never compromise with their basic tenets, which was to be represented through the embodiment of all the principles in the form of the Tirthankaras or the Jainas. They did never do it. But they did, because that was the need of the hour, to cater to the need of the society, aspirations of the society, of the people, earth, that was essential. They did it through by introducing jinn will remain as they were. They introduced a yaksh and a yakshi on two sides. Well, and the text says, well, if you come for worldly things, worldly longings you have, they will fulfill your desire. But not Tirthankaras, because they are there to teach you, show you, or take you on the path of the austerity or spirituality at the highest level. And Buddha, what did? He also suffered inflictions. But in that case, he performed miracles. And through miracles, he eradicated them. But in case of the Jainas, whether it is Parshunath or Mahavir, they did not perform any miracle to get rid of those inflictions. They remained unshaken, unperturbed, bearing all those inflictions. That is the beauty. And that is the beauty of art, which is very much in the spirit of Jainism. Next. Rishabhnath, you can see on the pedestal, nine planets, Navagrahas. And in compositional changes, they just make the change. The monotony is broken. Yaksh, you find here. With Rishabhnath, you find Gomukh Yaksh, Chakreshwari Yakshi on the pedestal two sides. They are there to fulfill the desires, worldly desires of the worshippers. There, again, rare image from Shatrunjay. Rishabhnath in deep meditation, flanked by Nami and Vinami. They were related to him and they came for some worldly things or vidyas, the magical powers. Of course, Rishabhnath was not going to give it because he is Vitragi. So, this was done by Dharanendra, who came all through and just granted them the vidyas, then they left. This is rare. Because the spirit of the Jain art, which is best represented in the image of the Tirthankaras, could be seen everywhere throughout. Next, please. Very important concept. 3rd century BCE image you have seen from Lohanipur, the earliest in Jain context, and the earliest of in Indian context, the earliest Indian cultic image which comes is of a Jain Tirthankar. And there is a tradition. We find Trishasti Shalaka Purush Charitra, Avashyak Churni, Avashyak Niryukti, which speaks of the Jivanta Swami, tradition of Jivanta Swami. Mahavir, who was averse to the worldly things from his early life, but he got married at the request of his brother, he wanted to relinquish the world. But on the request of the brother, he remained, but remained, you see, the way in the palace, standing in Kayasarga. And since he has not left the world as yet, he was provided with all the ornaments. And this image, earliest one, is of Shvetambar concept, Trishasti Shalaka Purush Charitra. Akota is a place in Gujarat, Baroda Museum mein hai ye. The inscription says, Jivit Swami Murti. The inscription also supports the tradition of Jivant Swami, textual tradition. And the Trishasti Shalaka Purush Charitra says that an early image of Jivanta Swami was recovered by Kumar Pal Chaulukya Solanki of Gujarat in mid-12th century from Veet Bhai Patan. Means the earliest example of archaeological excavation, you may also call. Anyway, next please. yes, next. You see, the tradition of Jivant Swami is prior to Mahavir, prior to renunciation. Diksha ke purva ka swarup hai. Alankaran abhushan hai kyunki rajpurush ke roop mein hai. But the another image, how the society works. We must always take into consideration the society. Acharyas are there on their direction. This and also in fulfillment of the desire, aspirations and need of the society, the things are being changed. You find here again Jivanta Swami, but of 11th century, his fifth. Within 6 centuries, what happened? The concept of Jivanta Swami, tradition of Jivanta Swami also became so popular that Jivanta Swami with all ornaments were also provided with the features of the jinn images. The central image you find the Trikshatra, which was an exclusive feature of a Jain Tirthankar. Shrivas in the chest, Kayusarga Mudra and Trikshatra. These were the 3 exclusive features. Trikshatra you find, and Chamar Dharaj and all other features. Besides that, Trikshatra is very important. And why Trikshatra? And why Trikshatra overhead? I just tried to contemplate, and that the only answer I could get, that above a Tirthankar, what thing can get the place? And it was the Triratna. Samyak Darshan, Samyak Gyan, Samyak Charitra. Right faith, right knowledge, right conduct. But that is the core. And that core comes above the Tirthankar, is being propounded by the Tirthankaras, but here a non-Tirthankar image is being provided with that. Next, rear. Another composite image. On the pedestal you find tortoise, Kurm. And Kurm is the cognizance of Muni Subhra, 20th Jinn. And just you gradually go to the top, because I am skipping other details. It is in State Museum, Lucknow. At the top you find a Tirthankar. On 2 sides of the central Tirthankar image, the figures of Balaram and Vasudeva Krishna, means Neminath. It becomes a composite image of Muni Suvrat and Neminath. This was very much in vogue. In Rajgir we find the image of Rishabhnath having 7-hooded snake canopy, cognizance bull. Sambhavnath with 7-hooded snake canopy. Very important. Means they also attempted at making composite images, and the basic purpose of making composite images was, which beautifully Raghuvansh describes, Vagartha viva sampriktav, Vagartha pratipattai, Jagatah pitarav vande Parvati. They are inseparable, like Vani, speech and meaning earth. So the inseparability means oneness of the two will lead to the non-conflict, or to the point of not being any one of the two being superior to the other, which has happened all through and which is happening all through. Next, that one is from Shravanbel Gol in Karnataka. Beautiful. Mahavir image, lion. But what the beauty is, you find on one side sun, on other side crescent moon. And on the lower side you find a cow standing with a calf. Auspicious symbol, Savatsa Go. बच्चे के साथ, बछड़े के साथ गाय, एन एलिफेंट. दीज ऑस्पिशियस सिंबल्स एंड सन एंड मून आर वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट इन नॉर्थ इंडिया, बट मोस्ट ऑफ द केसेस फ्रॉम साउथ इंडिया आई हैव सीन दैट
With the Tirthankar images, sun and moon are shown. The continuity of the tradition I can just show you. The commonality in Buddhist image with the Buddha I have seen, in Brahminical images I have seen, because that is to suggest the perennial importance of the discourses of these great preceptors, whether it is a Jain Tirthankar or a Buddha or that, and which comes down to the present day. Whenever we want to say in marriage songs, what we say, विवाह गीत में क्या कहते हैं कि आपका सुहाग तब तक अमर रहे जब तक सूरज और चांद रहे, कंटिन्यूटी ऑफ ट्रेडिशन. और हल्के में आ जाए तो नेताओं के लिए भी तो अक्सर हो जाता है कि जब तक सूरज चांद रहेगा फलाना आपका नाम रहेगा. बहरहाल, सो कंटिन्यूटी ऑफ ट्रेडिशन स्टिल टुडे. इफ आई कम आउट ऑफ माई हाउस एंड आई फाइंड अ काउ वेयर विद अ काफ who is just suckling the milk, I will treat it as an auspicious symbol, and I will think, well, this is good, with whatever purpose I am going out, that will be completed. तो मंगल चिन्ह की परंपरा जो रही है आज भी हमारे उसमें है. स्वस्तिक कल भी था, आज भी है. मंगल कलश कल भी था, हजारों साल पहले, आज भी है. हम उससे कहाँ मुक्त हैं? बुद्धिज्म मुक्त है कि जैनिज्म मुक्त है कि वैदिक पुराणिक ट्रेडिशन मुक्त है? तो वाई कांट वी थिंक इन टर्म्स ऑफ कॉमनिलिटी एंड शेयरिंग? आज हम शेयरिंग की बात करते हैं, हम रिलीजन में शेयरिंग क्यों नहीं एक्सेप्ट कर पाते? नेक्स्ट प्लीज. आई विल हैव टू बी फास्टर नाउ. नैरेटिव्स. डांस ऑफ नीलांजना, दैट वॉज द कॉज ऑफ द रेनन्सिएशन ऑफ ऋषभनाथ, mentioned in the Paumacharya Harivansh Purana. She is dancing and gradually he dies while dancing. And suddenly it comes in the mind of the Prince Adinath or Rishabh that, well, I was just enjoying the dance and the dancer died. So if it is life, we know in the case of Buddha also, the things which prompted him, which guided him to leave the world, has to be there, very important. Then transfer of embryo, which is exclusive to the Shvetambar tradition, is found in Mathura art. And here you see, then small panel in Kushan period, then 11th century, the complete Panch Kalyanakas from Garbh Kalyanak to the Nirvana. All the Panch Kalyanakas are shown, and you can see the auspicious dreams, then the birth, and after the birth, you see Isha. You find five figures plucking out the hair. Art, wonderfully in Jain context you find. In stone art, which is a frozen, how the continuity of the event is being suggested. Panchamushti, Keshalunchan, through one, another figure one, another figure one, five. So this is to be appreciated. And on the other side you find Bharat Bahubali. Then you find Samavasaran of Rishabhanath, and after Samavasaran, the Nirvana. This is also to be known that I asked Dhaki Sahib, ki Shayan Murti kyo nahi milti Tirthankar? Nirvana means jab bhi hoga death hogi to aadmi letega, reclining. Unka no, in Jain context, Nirvana ko they have shown through the standing figure, just nearby or close to the Samosaran, you find a Tirthankar standing. That represents the fifth Kalyanak Nirvana. Next. very significant contribution of Malli Swami or Mallinath, 19th Jin, who in Shvetambar tradition has been conceived as a female Tirthankara. Rarely their images are found. The Shvetambaras, apart from the common Shvetambar Digambar contributions, they have some specific contributions also. And here you find, in Digambaras, all the 24 Tirthankaras were men. But gradually, it was to be realized in the society that the following or the followers of Jainism include, in very good numbers, sometimes even greater number, the women. In South India, in North India, in Kushan period, we find a number of women. Veshya, Pratarik, Navik, Nartaki. Then what? How to explain? It was a subsequent edition, at least in 7th century, not prior to that. Agamic text doesn't refer to that. Then it was thought that, well, we should have a female Tirthankara and then Malli Swami and the rare images. This image was sent in the Victoria Albert and American art exhibitions, Jain art exhibitions. And this is another image which comes from Patan, Gujarat. Next. Innovation. Again, composite. The inscription gives the date. Samvat 1526 means 1469. The name is given Chandraprabha. The cognizance crescent is here carved. But seven-headed. Means seven or eight Tirthankaras were intended to be represented, out of which only three on both sides are represented. Central one stands for either two Tirthankaras, because Chandraprabha is the eighth Tirthankara, or since figure is in relief, not in round, the eighth face must have been on the other side. As we find in case of Mahesh, image of Elephanta, where also we find that the fourth image on the back is not shown because it is a relief, not figured in round. So they were making innovations. So rare of the rarest, the only example. Next, please. Few figures of Bahubali. Bahubali or Gomateshwar Bahubali, who was not a Tirthankar, ordinary man, but he became Kevali, he attained omniscience, Kevala Jnana, and was accorded such an exalted position that he was almost equal to the Tirthankaras. Whosoever were occupying a special reverence in the society, they were gradually elevated and made equal to the Tirthankaras, because they were the highest in Jain worship. And he is worshipped because, you see, he is in trance, Kayasarga. The creepers entwined all his body so beautifully. You see, the aesthetic, the way the creepers entwined the body, so beautiful, so rhythmic. Also the hair locks has to be there while standing for long. Another is from Aiholi. This is in Prince of Wales Museum, from somewhere from South India. Aiholi. Scholars usually took these two female figures as the Brahmi and Sundari, the two sisters. But I was surprised that why Brahmin and Sundari, as Sadhvi, are wearing mukutas and other ornaments. And this question led me to the probing, and the probing led me to the answer which I found in Harivansh Puran, Adi Puran. Jain context, Digambar. They said that while Bahubali was absorbed, here comes how the text has to be studied, and texts are taken, essentially taken into account while understanding the image. There may be changes, there may be some local additions and all that introduction, but the texts are always there. So the text says that in course of tapas, when the creepers entwined the body, the angels were, the apsaras were going from the sky. They came down and they just removed the vines or the creepers from the body, and they are doing it. So therefore they are the apsarases, not the sadhvis. I will show how sadhvis are shown. Next. Again, Bahubali. To this is important. Just keep in mind this figure, Bharat. Again from Ellora. Bharat with his wife, creepers and two Vidya Devis or Apsaras are there, angels are there. Next. This is the tallest Jain image. Recently few images were made of Rishabhnath in Maharashtra itself. But of the ancient period, this is the tallest Jain, not only Jain, but of all the Indian images, this happens to be the tallest one. So this is Jain contribution one. And second, why Bahubali not a Tirthankar? Here comes the question. It becomes unique not because it is the tallest 58 feet monolithic image, stands so imposingly, but perfectly in cool, shant, prashant. In text call, Trishashti Chalak Purush Charitra, as a shant murti, personified shant. This is something great. But because it gives a message through Jainism and through the visual representation in art, that whosoever observes the principles of Jainism in his or her life will gradually be elevated and will deserve worship or adoration, and may go to the extent of that, the point to be shown in Gomateshwar Bahubali. It is something like Ram and Krishna. We can't become Vishnu, we can't become Tirthankar, Jain, because they are destined to be Tirthankar. But Bahubali is a model, and by way of observing what he did, rigorous austerity, even unconcerned about the creepers, and I will show that somewhere the snakes, desert and scorpions were shown creeping on the body, but unconcerned, which made him great and worthy of worship and adoration to the extent that the tallest image was made. This is Mastakabhishek, which has just taken place last year. Next, please. The same has happened here, as we have seen with Saraswati. Bahubali has been put at par with the Tirthankaras. Trikshatri is there, lion throne is there, flyvis bearers are there. These are all the paraphernalia. The Ashtapratiharyas are to be shown only with the Tirthankaras, which were associated with Bahubali. So this was great, that even a personality, even a charitra who was not a Tirthankar, non-jinn character, was accorded such an exalted position. Next. In the ceiling from Shvetambar place, Kumaria is a very important place. You find Bahubali with creepers. And here we find the sadhvis. sister Shwetamba tradition. Her name is written Brahmi Sundari. Next. Here Brahmi and Sundari. Sadhvi Vesh. It comes from Shatrunjay. And elephant. Elephant means they reminded him at the command of Rishabhanath that why are you riding on the pride of like an elephant? So just get rid of this. And when reminded, he immediately got or attained omniscience. Another, Bahubali was accorded, but Bharat was not. But Bharat also subsequently renounced the world. Muni dharma he has taken, performed rigorous austerity, and then he also came to be shown in the images which were meant for worship. And here you can see close to the feet in Navanidhi's nine pictures are there representing Navanidhi, which were renounced because he was Chakravarti. He renounced sword, horse, elephant, all the insignia. But here symbolically nine vessels are shown, ghatas are shown. This becomes clear. So the concept was important. Without violating, they have been representing the forms and which we are just giving the messages and messages. Next. Shwetambar painting also. It is Digambar. So here you find Vidyadhari, Dhavala, Jai Dhavala, and there. Next. Vaishnavism was so preferred or imbibed in Jainism. You see, from Vimalavashahi, we find one of the most brilliant representation of Narasingha form. So dynamic, you see, Sthaun Narasingha. And here, Krishna plays holy with Gop and Gopikas. It comes from Jain tradition. It is in the Vimalavashahi series. And by 12th century, 1150, we do not find any representation in stone art or even in painting in Brahminical context of holy representation. It comes from Jain tradition. So it becomes here. Yes. And finally, dancing Indra. It comes from Tiruparuthi Kuvaram, Kanchipuram, Tamil Nadu. It's an information that in Digambar Puranas and even Trishashti Shalaka Purusharita, the supreme dancer is not Shiva, but the supreme dancer Nritu in Rig Veda is called, even Rig Vedic tradition called, it is not Shiva, but it is Indra. And they have taken that tradition, carried, and shown Indra as the supreme dancer. Indra is present on all the occasions, on the birth, on the annunciation, on the Diksha, Kalyanakas, close to the Tirthankaras. Indra comes and dances also. And it is just most dynamic and brilliant dance. So these were some of the rare images out of hundreds and hundreds others which I have just selected and tried to show you with the intention that the Jain art was equally innovative, not at all monotony was there, and also full of aesthetic appeal, changes, just having social context, social messages in all the forms. They were just making innovative forms where to give some social message, it was relevant. Not at all, and never they have violated the existing known textual tradition. With this, I thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Tiwari. May I now request Dr. Abhay Pirodia ji to say a few words.
आदरणीय पंडित जी, उपस्थित मित्रों, मुझे तो आज का ये प्रेजेंटेशन देख के बहुत ही हर्ष हुआ। उनकी जो प्रस्तुति आज की थी उसमें उन्होंने बताया कि भारत की जो आध्यात्मिक ट्रेडिशन है, परंपरा है, उसके अंदर मेल जोल और एकता ये फर्क से बहुत बड़ी है। और जो उन्होंने चित्र बताए जिसके अंदर पुरातन लगभग 2000 साल से लगा के 1000 साल पुराने जो शिल्प है उनके अंदर कितनी सुंदरता है, और आज के ज़माने में भी जबकि हम एक आधुनिक जग में रहते हैं जहाँ हमारा समाज के अंदर रहने का तरीका, देव देवताओं तीर्थंकरों के पास देखने का तरीका पहले से बहुत अलग है, फिर भी ये प्रतिमाएं आपके मन को छू जाती हैं। तो बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद, आपने इतना सुंदर प्रेजेंटेशन आज किया है। मैं दावे के साथ कह सकता हूँ कि यहाँ पे उपस्थित सभी लोगों को ये बहुत ही एक प्रकार से मार्गदर्शक है कि हमने किस तरह से हमारे पुरातन जो मूल्य है उनकी तरफ देखना चाहिए। ये आपका जो प्रेजेंटेशन है, हम चाहेंगे कि इसके ऊपर एक छोटी सी पुस्तिका बनाएं जो भंडारकर इंस्टीट्यूट की तरफ से हम प्रेजेंट कर सकें, अगर आप अनुमति दें तो। और अगर आप इसमें कोई और भी पुस्तक और भी चित्र जोड़ना चाहें तो कृपया जोड़ के हमें दीजिए, हम भंडारकर की तरफ से इसको इस आज के मौके को देखते हुए प्रसिद्ध करना चाहेंगे। धन्यवाद।
Thank you, Dr. Pirodia ji. It's always been a pleasure to listen to you, and thank you for making it a point to attend this function. I also extend my heartfelt gratitude towards Professor Tiwari for his enlightening lecture. We are really privileged to listen to him. We are also grateful to the family members of Dr. Prabha Joshi for the generous donation for instituting this lecture series. I thank the Pirodia Trust and its staff, especially Dr. Naveen Ji, Srivastav Ji, and Aarti Bapat for their cooperation in organizing this event. Thanks are due to Dr. Vijay Bedekar and his team in Thane for the live webinar of this lecture. I also thank media for the timely publicity of this event. Actually, there are many events in the city this evening. So today we have an audience who is really very much interested in the topic of today's lecture. I thank you all. Shri Pirodia Trust has organized another lecture of Professor Tiwari, which will be held on 18th November, this Sunday, at 10:30 in the morning at Pirodia Hostel. And the topic is Kala Mein Jain Achar Vishayak Nirupan. I request you all to attend this lecture. Thank you.